Merry Christmas, everyone. It is a delight to see you here today, and we welcome those of you here in person, those who will watch this online, and those who will watch the live stream later. Merry Christmas, one and all. I actually don't have any announcements this morning, so does anyone else? Nope, I see.
Good morning and Merry Christmas. No announcement. I'm Gail Yard. I just want to say on this beautiful Christmas morning, for me it's rather bittersweet. With Father Dano's last Sunday here, and we're so thankful that he's recovered from the flu and he's able to be with us. And I just want you to know how much you've meant to our family and the whole parish, and how much we love you and wish you all the best in your new journey.
Thank you, Gail. Thank you.
I'd like to say that I really enjoyed the choir music last night. It was outstanding. It was unbelievable. How good it was.
Amen to that.
Yeah.
I want to, and in the spirit of things, I really want to lift up Owen, because I was watching him last night, and it occurred to me that we have an organist choir master who's so smart and clever, he has figured out how to be two places at once, which has always been the problem and challenge, bedeviling the music ministry at St. John's. So Owen, hats off to you for figuring that out. I know it's not nearly as easy as you make it look, and the music, of course, was lovely last night, as it is always. I'm going to miss you all. Thank you for your kind words, Gail. Let's prepare our hearts and minds to worship God this morning.
Thank you.
God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be the kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
First reading is from the book of Isaiah. Upon your walls, O Jerusalem, I have posted sentinels all day and all night. They shall never be silent. You who remind the Lord, take no rest and give no rest until he establishes Jerusalem and makes it renowned throughout the earth. The Lord has sworn by his right hand and by his mighty arm, I will not again give your grain to be food for your enemies. And foreigners shall not drink in wine for which you have not labored. But those who garner it shall eat it and praise the Lord, and those who gather it shall drink it in my holy camps. Go through the gates, prepare the way for the people. Build up the highway, clear it of stones. Lift up an ensign over the peoples. The Lord has proclaimed to the end of the earth, say to the daughter of Zion, See, your salvation comes. His reward is with him, and his recompense before him. They shall be called the holy people, the redeemed of the Lord, and you shall be called sought out, a city not forsaken. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
You would stand with me and read the psalm with me. The Lord is King, let the earth rejoice, let the multitude of the gods be glad.
Clouds and darkness are around about him. Righteousness and justice are the foundations of his throne. A fire goes before him, and burns up his enemies on their side. His lightnings light up the world, the earth sees it.
The second reading is from Titus. When the goodness and loving kindness of God our Savior appeared, he saved us, not because of any work of righteousness that we had done, but according to his mercy through the water of the rebirth and renewal by the Holy Spirit. This Spirit he poured out on us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that having been justified by his grace, we might become heirs according to the hope. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
This day in the city of David, a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord.
Dear sisters and brothers, will you pray with me? May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. When I was growing up, and later, when I worked as a youth leader and the task of directing fell to me, the annual Christmas pageant always took one approach when it came to casting the shepherds. Those parts, the part of the shepherds, will be played by the rambunctious boys who couldn't sit still, remember lines, or be counted on not to make a scene. They were the shepherds, year after year. Even in a Christmas pageant, shepherds are on the margins. But in the much larger story, sisters and brothers, shepherds play a central role. For example, David was a shepherd. Before he was the mighty king of Israel, the one whose throne would endure forever, David was just a boy tending to sheep, easily overlooked. In 1 Samuel 16, we find the story of how David was chosen to be king. The prophet Samuel, guided by God, goes to Bethlehem, the small Judean town, and to the household of Jesse, one of the men of the town, because God has told Samuel that one of Jesse's sons would be the new king. And so there's a sacrifice and praise is given to God, and Jesse and his sons come, one by one, before Samuel. And when Samuel sees the first of these sons, Eliab, he thinks to himself, wow, this trip has been pretty easy. There he is, there's the new king, right? But God says to Samuel, do not look on his appearance or on the height of his stature, because I have rejected him. For the Lord does not see as mortals see. They look on the outward appearance, but the Lord looks on the heart. Poor Eliab. All he gets to be is tall and handsome, right? He doesn't get to be king. But that's okay. Samuel thinks Jesse's got other boys. And so one by one, they come before Samuel until finally the seventh son passes by and Samuel's a bit perplexed, like, none of these have been chosen. Jesse, would you by chance have another son that you forgot to bring with you? And Jesse answers, there remains yet the youngest, but he is keeping the sheep. And so it is with this great and powerful Davidic dynasty, right? This great and powerful Davidic dynasty at the core of our story. It begins with an overlooked shepherd boy tending to the flocks, not even important enough to get an invite to the coronation. And it reaches its culmination in Jesus of the house of David, born in that same small town, huddled in a stable, a manger for his bed. Who comes to pay him homage? The shepherds out in the fields, the actual successors to that boy David. This tells us something about God, that God chooses the unexpected and the overlooked, lifts up the lowly, brings good news to the poor, that God does not see people the way that we do. Even the prophets among us are biased towards the handsome and beautiful. But God sees deep into our hearts. So the shepherds that day, that night, they saw the angelic chorus. Only they saw that wonderful celestial display. Everyone else was asleep in their beds. It was the shepherds that got the good news. Not the priests, not the leaders of the town, not the merchants. It's these shepherds. There were plenty of people who got to sleep soundly and comfortably in their beds that night, but it was the shepherds keeping watch over their flocks, which is a very poetic way of saying working the graveyard shift, right? It's the shepherds keeping watch over their flocks that got to see Jesus. Any other night, they would have been forgotten. Any other royal proclamation, and they wouldn't have even gotten an invitation. But God chooses them to rejoice and bear witness that Jesus has come. Later in his life, Jesus will use a famous sermon illustration. "Which one of you," he asks, "having 100 sheep and losing one of them, does not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after the one that is lost until he finds it? And when he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders and rejoices. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, 'Rejoice with me, for I found my lost sheep.'" There's no way of knowing for certain, but I wonder if there aren't echoes in this parable of the stories Jesus would have heard from Mary and Joseph about the night he was born. About how shepherds left their flocks, left them in the fields, went off quickly to find him, filled with hope and expectation, leaving the sheep behind in order to find the Lamb of God, who takes away the sins of the world, and having found him, return to their friends and their neighbors, rejoicing in the glory and righteousness of God. There's no way of knowing if this parable echoes the story of Jesus' birth, but to me, it rings so true. The shepherds leave their flocks by night. They run to Bethlehem because there is that one that they are seeking. And when they find him, they go back into their lives, rejoicing with their whole hearts for the glory and righteousness of God. Now, of all the characters in this Christmas story, the one who captivates me the most is Mary. Here she is, young, far from home, in a stable, having just given birth. And these shepherds come in, right? With astounding news, yes, but also, well, how many people really want a bunch of smelly strangers showing up at the maternity ward? The wise men at least show up a few weeks later, and they bring gold. The shepherds are filled with enthusiasm, but they're a rambunctious lot. They show up uninvited, and they just kind of burst into the scene. But rather than kicking them out, Mary is able to hear their words and to treasure them. Not just to humor them, not just to find a way to get them out, but to hear their words and to treasure them. This is unbelievable grace and patience and empathy. To know that these men have something their hearts are bursting to share, and on the hardest night of your life, at least thus far, Mary's able to take time to listen to them. Hardest night of her life so far. And she still has time to listen to these shepherds. All of this is to say, God is one heck of a casting director. God really is. God saw something in David no one else could. Everyone else just saw a little boy fit for tending the sheep. God saw a king. God saw something in Joseph. And God definitely saw into Mary's heart and knew that she was the one for this incredible undertaking. God saw the hearts of the shepherds and knew that they would go and behold a child and not look askance, not be like, "Oh, we ran out here and it's just a baby." They wouldn't run out and try to take Jesus or find some way to get him to serve their own ends. No, that they had enthusiasm and passion, but they also had an innocence of their heart, a genuineness that they could go and celebrate and give thanks for this birth. God's one heck of a casting director, sisters and brothers. Doesn't look on outward appearances. Doesn't look as the world looks. But instead sees right into a person's heart. God sees right into your hearts this morning. God sees your hearts too. Here you are, gathered around a manger, having braved dreadful cold on perhaps the most skipped Sunday of this church year, and yet, here you are. What did you leave behind, like the shepherds, to come and encounter Jesus this morning? And when you leave this place, will you go rejoicing and telling others this good news? Hopefully some of you will. A child has been born for us. Do not be afraid, the angel says, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This news is as powerful today as it was on that Judean hillside some 2,000 years ago. For this is good news for all people, those alive, those gone to glory, those yet unborn, that Jesus has come to save us, that God's desire to be with us is not going to be impeded. It will not be impeded. Peace, reconciliation, redemption, all of these things are present and possible in and through Jesus. Now God's one heck of a casting director. To bring Jesus into this world, to bring this precious gift to us, took discipleship. The might of David, the courage of Mary, the steadfastness of Joseph, the encouragement of Elizabeth, even the shepherds who celebrate play a part. And behind the scenes, there are surely midwives and aunties and people who love this couple. When we were kids, we divided up the parts of the Christmas pageant. But as adults, it's really not all that much different. God sees our hearts. What role is God inviting you to play in the Christmas story this year? The world is out there, sisters and brothers, and it needs disciples. It needs patience and empathy and courage and steadfastness. It needs generosity and behind the scenes workers who get little credit but do much good. It needs rambunctious people who can't sit still but know a miracle when they see it. It needs you. Anyone else could have come to hear the Christmas message this morning, but God chose you, and here you are. What is your role going to be? Merry Christmas. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Father, we pray for your Holy Catholic Church. Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name be glorified by all peoples.
We pray for Michael, our presiding bishop, Mark, our bishop, Dana, our priest in charge, and for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for Joe, our president, members of Congress, and Andy, our governor, and for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give us grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our works may find favor in the sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
That they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let light precious shine on them.
We praise you for your saints who have entered into joy.
And we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
God, you make us glad by the yearly festival of the birth of your only Son, Jesus Christ. Grant that we, who joyfully receive him as our Redeemer, may with sure confidence behold him when he comes to be our Judge, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Almighty God, have mercy on you. Forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, because you gave Jesus Christ, your only Son, to be born for us, who, by the mighty power of the Holy Spirit, was made perfect man of the flesh of the Virgin Mary, his mother, so that we might be delivered from bondage of sin and receive power to become your children. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died.
Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ, by him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread.
the gifts of God for the people of God. Thank you. May Christ, who by his incarnation gathered into one things earthly and heavenly, fill you with his joy and peace. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.